Welcome to Tokyo College Webinar. I'm Masaki Sano, Deputy Director of Tokyo College. Tokyo College is aiming to share new knowledge for an inclusive society. Today we deliver a lecture meeting entitled Understanding the Physics of Virus Transmission. COVID-19 pandemic is spreading around the world as we are approaching winter. To prevent the spread of virus, understanding how it is transmitted via air currents during conversation and social interactions is essential. Today, I would like to introduce two prominent speakers who are doing the cutting-edge research on this issue. The first speaker is Professor Howard Stone from Princeton University in USA. He's a distinguished chair professor in mechanical and aerospace engineering. His research interests are in fluid dynamics, especially at the interface of engineering, chemistry, physics, and biology. He's the first recipient of the Bachelor Prize in fluid dynamics. He recently published a series of papers on pathogen transmission in speech. The second speaker is Professor Makoto Tsubokura at Graduate School of Systems Informatics, Kobe University. He's also the team leader of Complex Phenomena Unified Simulation Research Team at Riken Center for Computational Science. He specializes in computational fluid dynamics. As many of you may have seen on Japanese TV news recently, he has conducted research on droplet transmission in conversations and different social interactions by using the world's fastest supercomputer Fugaku. And from now, each talk will last about 35 minutes. Then we'll have a Q&A session after each talk. If the audience has questions, please use the Q&A function by clicking the bottom of your PC. You can type questions anytime during or after the talk. We'll pick up from those questions. Now, let's start the session. Professor Stone, please start your presentation.
Can you see my screen, Professor Seno?
Yes, yes, fine.
So good morning, everyone. I'm pleased to speak to you on some work we started in about April when the pandemic started, at least in the United States. And this is a team effort, and there have been many contributors to the work we've done. And so I'm going to tell you about how we've been thinking about this problem of speech as a potential driver of virus transmission. So I'd first like to thank the organizers, in particular, Professor Masaki Seno for this opportunity. And I'm honored to join Professor Tsubokura in this webinar on understanding the physics of virus transmission. So the outline for my talk is shown here. I'm gonna first just provide a little background in the airborne spread of the current virus, and then tell you a little about how we went about studying how ordinary speech can play a role in transporting droplets, which are the carriers of the virus. And we've done some work also in the laboratory to visualize one mechanism for how droplets are actually formed in speech. We've done some other work that I won't have time to talk about, including not only asking about social distancing in terms of distance, but how long you might want to be near someone when you're in a casual environment with them. And at the very end, I'll show you one slide on trying to quantify some features of masks. So my group works in fluid mechanics. And so we asked the question, how can fluid mechanics concepts provide new qualitative and quantitative insights regarding airborne spread of a virus? We've done this by using laboratory experiments, computer simulations, and mathematical models. And on this slide, I will just now summarize the main themes you'll see in the next 30 minutes. In particular, we'll use these ideas to understand some of the features of flow. The flow when you speak is somewhat complex, but it will look approximately like a cone of exhaled material. Other people have used experiments to show that when you speak louder, you produce more droplets. And in language, there are different kinds of sounds. In particular, in English, we refer to plosive sounds as sounds that come from a slightly pressurized oral cavity, and those can propagate quite efficiently, easily reaching 2 meters. We'll also show you how you can visualize the droplets that can be formed as your lips open when you speak. And if you're interested in the idea of social distancing, we'll emphasize the need to think about time as well, how long you spend near someone. Now, obviously, there's an enormous work in the research and public health literature. So many of these themes, of course, are talked about by others. And I will give some references as I go along. Now, to maybe put in perspective where we are today, I just looked up on Google, of course, that the population of Japan is about 125 million people. And unfortunately, the number of cases of the virus have increased substantially. So they're now about 2,000 per day in Japan, according to the web. The trends look a little like this. And as Professor Sano said, the numbers are going up as we approach the colder winter and you spend more time inside. Unfortunately, the case is much worse in the United States, where I live. Our population is not quite 3 times the population of Japan. But unfortunately, the number of cases per day that are being recorded in the United States are 100 times those being recorded in Japan. And that, of course, is making life difficult for many, many Americans. So I thought I would just record for you some of the things that you can read. I'll just read them to you. You can find the following. The most astonishing thing about the pandemic was the complete mystery which surrounded it. Nobody seemed to know what the disease was or where it came from or how to stop it. And the disease may be transmissible before the patient himself is aware that he is attacked. Healthy persons often carry about in their persons the germs of disease, thereby unconsciously acting as a continuing danger to themselves and a menace to others. You might ask when these words were written. In fact, they were written in 1919, 1 year after the 1918 pandemic, as people look back on that tragedy. And I think it's sad to say when you read these words that in many ways we have done no better today in preparing ourselves for this kind of disease. So let me now turn to the first theme, which is just reminding you probably what you're already aware of, which is the evidence for the airborne spread of the virus. And in fact, there's been some evidence already since the early days of the pandemic that there are many examples of the spread of the virus by individuals who don't have symptoms. So in English, we refer to those as pre-symptomatic spread or asymptomatic spread. So there are cases, of course, on ships, in offices, by choirs. And it's important to note that although in some disease transmission, coughing and sneezing play a major role, apparently in this disease, coughing and sneezing play a much reduced role. And in fact, it's those people without symptoms who, through their casual interactions and activities, are spreading the virus. You can find evidence for this already back in January, at least in the English language literature, where in Germany, a case was spread in a hotel conference room between visitors from a company and an overseas visitor. And there's a well-known case of course, there are many well-known cases, but another case of a fitness class, an exercise class where you're breathing more heavily in South Korea. Now, these all give evidence of airborne spread of the virus. And in that case, ventilation, of course, is very important, how the room air is cleaned and refreshed. I'm not going to talk in my talk about the scale of the room. I'm going to talk about the scale of the individual and their few friends, which I will refer to as local or direct interactions. And I think Professor Subakura will be saying more about both of these problems. So you can find in the literature on building safety and other areas of the literature on diseases, some studies of airflow. For example, in the image shown at right from a paper published in 2013, people were trying to image some features of the flow created when you either breathe or, in this case, sneeze. And others, for example, the group of Lydia Baruba at MIT, have studied quantitative features of coughing and sneezing. Now, in the literature on fluid dynamics, which is where I come from, there's also literature where people have studied some simple sounds, which we'll refer to as syllables, in addition to studying coughs and sneezes. For example, you'll see later in this talk that the sound pa, which is a plosive sound, in fact, is particularly effective at transporting exhaled air. And in a quantitative sense, in fluid mechanics, we often try to quantify how far a flow propagates in time. So if T is time, it's known in the fluid mechanics literature that you often get a propagation, a distance that varies as time to a power n, where if you just look at a flow coming out of an orifice or out of your mouth or out of an opening, at early times it propagates as the square root of time. Whereas if you have a isolated puff or burst of air, a little like these pictures shown to the right, then they propagate as proportional to time to the 1/4 power, which is slower. And what I'll show you is that speech has its own characteristics that makes it more efficient traveling over long distances than these others. Now, not surprisingly, there's an enormous literature on disease transmission. And an important name in that field is Wells, who studied many features of the small droplets that come out of your mouth. They may settle, as Professor Subakura will tell you about, or they may evaporate and stay airborne. And there you can even find already back 70 years ago, if not almost 80 years ago, images showing what happens when you sneeze, for example. And these authors already, even 80 years ago, looked at what happens when you wear a mask and showing some of the effectiveness of a mask. Now we see this, of course, being studied today, but this just points out the large literature that's available for giving hints about these questions. And there are many groups, in particular the group cited here and many others, that have looked at questions about the droplets being formed as you undergo many activities. And it's these droplets that are potentially carrying the virus. Now, my concern when I started this work, we decided to focus on casual activities, everyday activities, and speech is one of them. And Bill Ristenpart's group, who's at the University of California, Davis, has studied some of the features of language and how in English, the vowels and consonants associated with language produce droplets. And they've also shown that louder speech produces more droplets. And of course, that's important because if you go into a crowded room or a restaurant or a bar and are forced to speak louder, you're also producing more droplets, which then makes the space, if you like, a riskier space if what your concern is the virus that's being transmitted by potentially an infected person. So we wanted to look at this question of casual interactions between two people, but we didn't want to look at it initially at the scale of the ventilation of the room. We wanted to look at it in a close interaction where the people were only a few meters apart. And I should say, going back, that if you're interested, I'm sure there's much in Japan, but there's quite a lot now in the United States trying to help people think about the different levels of risk that take place when you're in a space and effectively sharing the air you breathe with others in the room. And you may not know, of course, whether there's an asymptomatic person present carrying the virus. So let me now tell you how we went about this question of looking at local interactions where a virus might be transported between two people. So first of all, we're going to use experiments and simulations to look at this question. And you might ask, if you get together with groups of people, what are the risks that are entailed when you're speaking close to one another? Oh, and I should say, so I'll refer to, in some places, I'll refer to the speaker who might be infected as the host, and I'll refer to a healthy person nearby as a susceptible individual. Okay, so we went about this using experiments and simulations. So in fluid mechanics, you need to specify the speed of a flow. When you breathe and when you speak, the typical fluid speeds are on the order of 1 to 5 meters per second. And there's a way you characterize this that's called the Reynolds number, which tells you whether the flow might be laminar, so relatively simple, where the flow moves in simple, almost like sheet-like structures, or whether the flow is turbulent and rapidly overturning and mixing with its environment. And the flows that are associated with speaking and breathing have a Reynolds number range on the order of 1,000 to 7,000 or 10,000. So they tend to be weakly turbulent. So we got permission from the university to go back to the lab one person at a time. When we began this, the university was closed and the only labs allowed to operate were those that were doing some research associated with COVID-19. I was being visited by a wonderful friend and experimentalist, Manouk Abkarian, who's a French scientist who was spending 4 months visiting my research group. And Nan Sue is a graduate student in my group who helped set up the experiment. And you see it here. We used a green laser to create a laser sheet, a sheet in the lab, and we looked at it nearly perpendicular to the sheet using a high-speed camera. And we used a Halloween fog, which is a fog of small droplets, common, say, to plays and theaters, to fill the room with fog. And wherever the fog intersects the laser sheet, you see it as white. I'll show you on the next slide, we're able to visualize the movement of the fluid this way. And then down below, there are images that we can create using image processing to track the experimental features. You can also use the laser sheet as another means. You can stand in front of the laser sheet, and when you speak in front of it, when little droplets from your mouth cross the laser sheet, they form speckles. And this follows a procedure that was published earlier this year by a group at NIST. So what do we see? If you say an ordinary phrase like, sing a song of six pence, then what you observe when you do this is a little motion associated with sing a song, and then the pence produces this big vortex that goes out of your mouth. You can see on the right-hand side, my colleague Manu Kapkarian, and he's wearing goggles because we're in a lab with a laser. And then the image processing down below allows you to track the movement of the air. And this image is already a meter long. And so you can see in just 1 to 2 seconds, a phrase like this propagates air already more than a meter. You should know that the World Health Organization recommends social distancing of a meter. And you can question whether, after seeing this single phrase, whether that's a safe thing to do or not. You can quantify these features. And if you do that, what you see is if you plot the distance propagated versus time, at very short times on the order of a fraction of a second, all the data points, if you make a special graph that's called a log-log graph, where you use logarithmic axes, at early times, you get a variation which is L proportional to time to the 1/2 power, as I pointed out to you, was already known about in the fluid mechanics literature if you think about starting a jet-like flow. And when a single phrase like pence propagates, on this kind of graph, you see that when a single phrase propagates at the time scale of, say, a second, it propagates as time to the 1/4 power, which was referred to as a puff. And it's similar to what you'd get if you coughed. We then started to look at this different ways. We started to track individual phrases and then played them over and over again. Here is a plosive sound P played in slow motion. And you can see it exiting your mouth. And then it propagates as a fluid mechanics person would refer to as a vortex. And when you then repeat the sound, so you continue speaking, the next vortex tries to overtake the first one and pushes it forward. So we continually looked at this kind of study. And over time, what we observe is that if you continually say phrases that contain plosives, you tend to get a conical jet-like structure that easily propagates one, if not more, meters. We then decided to ask, since we were collecting experimental data, could we also do numerical simulations, computer simulations, using the laws of fluid mechanics to quantify and understand these flows better? And Professor Subakura, I'm sure, will show you even more a richer set of computer simulations. And our work was done with a colleague in France, Simone Mendes. We replaced the human head. We thought of it as a sphere, and we replaced the mouth by a small opening or orifice that had an elliptical shape about the size of an open mouth. And then we asked, what could we say about the flow features when you speak? Now, we wanted to think about speech, and we were aware already in the 1960s of in the literature on speech and language, that people had measured the flow rate during ordinary phrases. For example, as I said before, this phrase, sing a song of six pence, the P being the strong plosive. And we digitized this data so that we had an input signal that was, if you like, a flow rate, which is like you exhaling as a function of time. And then to mimic speech, we repeated this phrase over and over again. So here I show three cycles of sing a song of six pence, inhale, sing a song of sixpence, inhale, sing a song of sixpence. So to represent someone speaking to a friend. We then did this with also the phrase, Peter Piper picked a peck, which has so-called many plosives. And these are the so-called boundary conditions or inflow for what happens at the mouth. And I've shown you this right at the beginning. We then did many simulations where we try to study this time evolving speech pattern. You can see there's a mark over here on the side of about 2 meters. And within 40 seconds of speeching, this cloud of small particles, we think of these as just either aerosols that stay suspended or just what a person would call a tracer in the air that tells you where the air goes. It goes almost 2 meters in 40 seconds. And you see also that as it propagates, it looks almost like a conical structure. And although the flow is turbulent and it had an input that was time varying, it looks sort of what you'd call steady, or a fluid mechanics person would call quasi-steady. And it has exactly the features that you associate with just injecting water into another bath of water, which is called the starting jet problem, which also has a conical jet-like structure, not so dissimilar to what you see here. Now, we wanted to quantify this to try to understand quantitatively, not just with the experiment or not just with the computer, how this happens. So we did some time averaging of the typical velocities you see as a function of how far you are from a speaker. And as you move away from a speaker, the velocity decreases. And as you speak over and over and over again, the air moves further and further away from the speaker. But the speed follows a typical time spatial dependence, which it goes as 1 over the distance, where X is the distance from the speaker. And this spatial dependence that the velocity or speed varies as 1 over distance is also exactly what you would get if you had a turbulent, steady jet. And because we understand then the spatial dependence, we can understand more about where the jet is able to reach. And you can show that the distance traveled by your exhaled air will vary as the square root of time. This is much faster than you'd have if you had a cough or a sneeze, which only goes as time to the quarter. Continuous speaking will go proportional to the square root of time. And the inputs in this law include the opening size of your mouth and the typical velocity or speed at which you're speaking. And finally, shown here, this alpha is just the jet angle, which is the cone I've already shown you. We compared this with our numerical simulations, where we plotted a distance normalized by the typical radius of the orifice or the size of the mouth versus time, suitably so-called scaled. And at the early time result that you might expect if you had a so-called starting jet was the T to the half. The puff or cough is T to a quarter. And our numerical data at early times is the starting jet. An individual phrase is just like a puff, but speaking many sentences produces this repeated sentence or square root law. And our experimental data, when plotted on normal axes of distance versus time, our experimental data shown by the data points falls very close to this red curve, which is the analytic or formula shown at the top. And you should note that, again, within 30 or 40 seconds of speaking, when you have phrases involving these plosive-like sounds, you easily exceed 2 meters, if not sometimes approach 3 meters. And again, that's beyond what you refer to as normal social distancing rules when you speak without a mask. Now, we were also interested in saying something about how droplets might be formed. And so we looked a little at this question of drop formation in speech. And we also asked a little about mitigation. And this term rheology is telling you about the mechanics of the liquid of and how a liquid like your saliva is deformed when it's trying to flow. Now, if you go to the literature on droplets and aerosols, there are two hypotheses in the literature for where droplets come from that you exhale. One statement is that droplets are formed deep in the lung when the lung bursts, or that when you breathe, your airflow goes through your upper airways over liquid-lined walls, and the airflow produces small droplets. These are both, plausible ideas, but I think it's fair to say it's not easy to image either of these directly. There's indirect methods used to understand the droplets that are produced in speech, and there's a very rich literature of this that I've already given you some references to. What we did was to try to provide an alternative view of where some droplets will come from. And I just want to remind you, as I've already said, that when you speak louder, it's already been confirmed that you produce more droplets. So we turned a high-speed camera on the mouth of my colleague here, Manuk Abkarian. So here are his lips. You're going to see as we play the movie, he's going to say pa-pa, which is a plosive. His lips open at the scale of milliseconds. And as the lips open, you see there's a sheet of saliva that rapidly becomes threads or little liquid filaments of saliva that are stretched by the airflow and then break up into small droplets. And this feature then allowed us to study or to think about what is it about the saliva that leads to this formation of droplets directly at your lips when you speak. And again, you can then start to visualize, if you want, droplets being produced anytime you have moist lips. We quantified some aspects of this and wanted to just point out that this is one mechanism for producing droplets. Some of these are big and will rapidly fall to the ground, I think, as Professor Subakura will show. Smaller ones evaporate quickly and, of course, may remain then airborne. You might ask, if this happens when you have moist or wet lips, what can you do about it? And we noticed that if you want to keep liquid off your lips, you can use a lip balm, which you put on your lips in the winter, or even lipstick. And what we observed is whenever you had this lip balm on your lips, you tended not to produce many, if not any, droplets. Of course, when you lip your lips enough and they become wet again, then you start to produce droplets. Okay, so because that drop formation happens when your lips open, we noticed that this might apply to some musical instruments. Wind instruments, for example, those that have a wooden reed, which vibrates up and down, also show the same kind of feature. This again is a movie taken with a high-speed camera. You can see the time scale in the lower left. So this reed is vibrating at a scale up and down of milliseconds, so faster than your lips open. And again, you can see filaments of saliva present, and you can imagine that this can also lead to droplets. And you know that sound is produced in your vocal cords or the glottis. And you can find movies online of how the vocal cords work. I think you can hear a sound here. I give the reference. And you can imagine when these two soft surfaces touch each other and open up, they will also be producing droplets just as we showed when your moist lips open. So these are sort of generic features we think about where droplets and how droplets can be formed, at least one mechanism for that. Finally, I'll just say we have work in progress on flow with masks. Masks are well known to you as being a critical part of fighting the pandemic. Masks cut off the flow so you no longer get this large-scale propagation. And masks also filter some of the material, both leaving the mask or coming into the mask. And this is work we have in progress. And unfortunately, as you're aware, in the United States, we've had a challenge getting a large part of the population to wear masks. Here's some of the work we're doing, and I'll just end with that. We can measure in my lab the flow rate versus time. We can do this for whether you just breathe through your nose or breathe through your nose and mouth or breathe heavily or just try and blow out of your mouth. We were loaned a camera by the FLIR company, who I have to thank, that lets us do infrared or so-called IR imaging of the CO2 signal. And you can see in all these movies that you can watch as the air leaves your mouth by tracking the carbon dioxide that's present in the exhaled air. And whenever you wear a mask, you can see there's no large-scale flow away from the person. The flow gets out maybe 10-ish centimeters, even when you're just blowing hard, and that there's always some leakage in the mask we were using. Finally, I'll then just close with this one feature that we can measure, and this is too cluttered, so just know we can measure distance versus time, either the horizontal distance shown in the graph at the left, or the vertical distance shown in the graph at the right. And notice the numbers here are at most 10 to 15 centimeters, so no longer 1 to 2 meters. And when the air gets out, of course, it mixes with the air in the room, and therefore ventilation starts to play a big role. So that just gives you some idea of how we're trying to quantify these ordinary activities associated with speech. And I'll just leave you with these summary ideas. We've tried to quantify airflows. I've told you about some of the features of language or the phonetic signatures that influence the airflows. I've shown you one feature we've tried to quantify about drop formation. I did not have time to tell you what probably you're already aware, but it's not just social distancing, but also contact time near people. And to give you some ideas of other work we're doing, we've been working with the musicians at the Met Orchestra in New York. And there we've been doing CO2 imaging. And if you can hear the sound, I'll show you some work we did in my lab recently with one of their marvelous sopranos, Isabel Leonard, tracking the flow as she sings. And with that, I'd like to stop. And I just want to thank the National Science Foundation and my program manager, Ron Jocelyn, for the support that made this work possible. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Stone. Now we can have a few questions from the audience.
You asked for a 35-minute talk, and I think I did it in 34 minutes. So I hope
okay. Yeah, still we have time. So there is a question. For instance, so you suggest that putting lip balm, does it help the winter environment? And the putting lip balms on the
so what we have observed, and we have not done a public health study on this, and no one has picked up on it, but what we observed is that when you speak, you produce droplets. People have shown that, and we've also shown that. But what we did show is that one mechanism of the production of those droplets are your moist lips. And if you put lip balm on your lips, which we often do in the winter, and in fact, I often carry around with me, that while you have the lip balm on your lips, we observe very few, if any, droplets being produced. So of course, as you lick your lips, you tend to start to wet them again. But our observations in our limited number of studies is that lip balm is one way to reduce the direct formation of droplets on your lips, there might be other mechanisms, of course, of droplet formation.
Okay.
I carry around lip balm and I put it on a few times a day.
I see. There's more question about the mechanism of the creating droplet from the lip. So what kind of material property plays a key role to make this drop? Is it surface tension or viscosity?
Oh, so in what we observe, now, as I said, there are two other mechanisms that people talk about. But if you want to understand the mechanism I showed you, which is as the lips open, you see the a liquid film of saliva at very short times forms a sheet, and that sheet then breaks into liquid filaments. The only way you can explain how those filaments are stretched and then the flow pulls them out is there must be some elasticity in the fluid. And the elasticity in the fluid is the polymers that are present in your saliva, typically mucin or other things in your saliva. So pure water wouldn't form the long filaments that you see. It must be something else in the fluid. And in the literature on saliva, the rheology of that material is associated with an elastic-like fluid that helps it remain stable while it's being stretched, and eventually it will break into small droplets. So surface tension will generally be responsible for breaking it, and viscosity along with the elasticity allows the filament to get longer. And as it gets longer, it gets narrower. And as it gets narrower, it can break into smaller droplets.
Okay, thank you. So there's another question. Says the number of new cases increased during winter, probably because low temperature and dry air. Can you give any reasoning to it from fluid mechanics?
So there are studies out about the role of temperature and humidity, but it may be, and some of those studies, they don't all agree with each other, but it may be, at least the way I read the literature, that during winter, you spend more time inside. Inside, you tend to have less fresh air than you do outside. And so there are many more contacts that put you in contact with people where you're sharing their air. And so it may have very little to do with, if you like, the temperature on the droplets. It has to do with the temperature and you wanting to not be outside where you're interacting with people when there's a lot of fresh air around. You're in smaller spaces, more confined spaces, and when you share air with someone who may be infected, you have a higher probability of catching the virus. And a common way this is discussed in the States is if someone is smoking, you can smell that smoke already if you're in another corner of the room. If you can smell smoke or think you could smell perfume, you can just as well be inhaling aerosol particles from that person. And so I think the answer to your question is more, the winter is dangerous because we're indoors more, we're sharing smaller spaces more, and it's harder to protect ourselves and to get more fresh air.
Okay, thank you very much. So we have to proceed to the second talk. So after the second talk, we can accept the common question to the two speakers. So second speaker is Professor Makoto Tsubokura from Riken and Kobe University. Could you start, please?
Okay, thank you very much, Sano-sensei, for the kind introduction and also inviting me to this wonderful seminar. I'm Tsubokura from Riken and Kobe University. Today, I would like to introduce our latest research of viral droplet aerosol dispersion in indoor environment using world fastest supercomputer, Fugaku. To begin with, I would like to talk about backgrounds and motivations of our research. We think that unfounded contempt or scientific unscientific fear against COVID-19 is simply because the virus is not visible. So visualizing the flight paths of droplets and the dispersion of invisible aerosol based on scientific simulations will contribute to evaluate its infection risk and to propose countermeasures. So-called capacity computing is suitable for the fight against COVID-19, and high-performance computing is indispensable for a reliable and rapid simulation to evaluate infection risk to enormous situations and cases. This figure on the left indicates the experimental data of droplet size distributions in the case of person coughing. The size distribute from hundreds micrometers down to less than 1 micrometer, with its peak around 10 micrometers. These experimental data as input, we simulate the dispersions of droplets like this. Here, as you see, larger droplets than 10 micrometers fall down within 1 meter of the cougher, which is indicated by red color, while smaller droplets indicated by blue with its size less than 10 micrometer rapidly evaporate and become smaller than 5 micrometers and drift in the air. These smaller droplets are sometimes called aerosols and drift in the air for their very, very long time of more than 30 minutes. The hardware we are utilizing for our simulation is Fugaku, the world's fastest supercomputer with its peak performance of 488 petaflops operated since this spring. It consists of about 160,000 CPU based on ARMv8.2 architecture. Fugaku achieved not only top 500, but also HPCG, HPLAI, and Graph 500 twice in a row at the International Supercomputing Conference and the Supercomputing Conference this year. The software utilized in this project is called Cube, developed in our team at the weekend. This is a sort of in-house software, but established as a collaboration of many, many industrial partners. We adopted a hierarchically structured finite volume method as a data structure shown here. This is a hierarchically structured mesh. We first decompose the spatial domain by cubic cell, or here we call it a cube. With a different size based on the octatree algorithm, then same number of numerical meshes is allocated to each cube with different size. By distributing the same number of cubes to each CPU in the parallel simulations, computational load for each CPU becomes exactly the same. This is a way we achieve the high parallel performance. This is for the considerations of utilizing massively parallel simulations and the easy tuning on the new hardware architecture. Another idea of this software is we would like to solve multiple partial differential equations of fluid motions, solid deformations, acoustics, and chemical reactions, and so on. On the unified data structure to avoid unnecessary interpolations and the data communications among each CPU. These are some examples of numerical results obtained by our simulation software Cube. On your left, it's a narrow band noise predictions emitted from the full-scale vehicles. Here that you can see the sound emitted in the front part of the vehicles, and also we can solve the turbulence directly both in the simulations. In the middle is deformations of the white body of road vehicles, and on your right is the simulations of internal combustion engine. Actually, this is the key of solving the COVID-19 because In this COVID-19 simulations, we do not prepare the new technique for the simulations, but we just utilize the algorithms for the internal combustion engines. You know, in the piston, in the cylinder, fuel is ejected, and it's a sort of the droplets, and which rapidly evaporate, and the ignition occurs in the engines. This this phenomena is more or less similar to the transportation of droplets. So we utilize this technique for the COVID-19 simulation. Now I'd like to move on to the detail of the numerical method. The flow solver that we use for the saliva droplet modeling is composed of two primary things. One is an Eulerian solver to model the air fluid flow on it is shown on the left, and the other is a Lagrangian solver to model the droplet dynamics. On the Eulerian domain, free compressible Navier-Stokes equations along with the vapor and the spaced transport equations are solved. On the Lagrangian part, particle domains, the droplet evaporations and the transport equations are solved to track the size, temperature, and positions of each droplet. A dark model based on the relative velocities of the droplet and ambient air is used to update the droplet velocity and its positions. And the drag of the air is depending on the Reynolds number shown here. The evaporation model consists of a temperature update here and the mass update here. The temperature equations updates the droplet temperature based on the heat exchange due to conduction at the droplet air interface and heat loss due to the evaporations at the droplet surface. And the mass update equation tracks the evaporation rate, which accounts for the transport of the water vapor at the droplet surface. For the droplet wall interaction model on the right, we use a stick bounce model subject to a critical Weber and the Laplace number criterion shown here. If the Weber number is less than around 3000 times Laplace to the power of minus 0.2, then the droplet is assumed to a stick on the wall. Now I would like to show you some results of the simulations in the case people speaking, singing, and coughing. These animations indicate how droplets and aerosol spreads in the air when we speak. In the left and singing on the in the middle and the coughing twice in the right. For the speaking and singing case, we assume that a person count from 1 to 10 in English for 5.5 seconds and repeat that one. When speaking about 900 droplets emitted per minute, while the 2,500 droplets are emitted when the singing in the middle, in the case of coughing, the person cough twice in less than 1 second. And a total of about 30,000 droplets emitted in this case. These figures indicate the boundary conditions we used for this simulation. This is the velocities. These three are velocities, and these are the profiles of the droplet droplet size and the numbers. Regarding the simulations of face masks, we do not precisely solve the detailed textile of each mask, but it is modeled. It is modeled by the pressure droplet or equivalent aerodynamic drag of masks materials together with filter efficiency. These fluid dynamic characteristics of masks material as input, we conduct numerical simulations on flow around the masks. For this purpose, we conducted intensive experimental measurements shown here. For the filter efficiency, we count particles before and after each filter materials using a particle counter. Here, we count only the droplets of the size between 0.3 micrometers up to 10 micrometers. So we do not count the particles larger than that. For the pressure drop, we measure pressure difference before and after the filter materials. Then we can obtain the relationships between the filter efficiency as a verticals and the pressure drop as a horizontal shown here. This is the experimental data, and we use these ones as a numerical inputs, okay? But this is a very interesting figure, so I would like to explain that. First, please note that the filter efficiency rate is based on the number of particles emitted. Results of various commercial novel non-woven masks are shown here, which is indicated by circles, while the dose of fabric masks, like t-shirts, bed sheets, and the gauze, and so on, are shown by square. It is around here. And the so-called face masks for sports activity made by the urethane are indicated by closed triangles. For reference, medical use commercial mask called N95 is indicated here. Generally, we can say that the filter efficiency becomes better as the pressure drop becomes larger. And among three types of face masks, non-woven masks shown around here show the better performance of filtering, while their pressure drop are also relatively higher than the fabric mask. On the other hand, when you look at the fabric mask, pressure drop of these masks are relatively slower, so you can easily breathe when you wear these masks. While their performance distributing from 10% up to the 70%. Among the three types of materials, we can say that urethane masks performance is worst. Then now I'd like to show you what happens when we wear masks on your face. This figure shows us similar figures I previously showed you. Here, the horizontal is a material's pressure drop, which is the same as the previous. But for the verticals, please note that this is, in this case, this is the mask's filtering efficiency. Once you wear a mask, there's some leakage between the face and the mask. So the more or less the performance is going to be degraded. First, please look at the result of a non-woven mask, so-called commercial mask. It is remarkable that these masks' filtering performance is significantly degraded, and it's sometimes below the fabric mask as shown here. This is because a non-woven mask's pressure drop is relatively larger than the fabric mask. And more flaws and aerosols leaks from the gap between the face and the mask. This is the reasons of the performance degraded once you wear the non-woven mask on your face. It also should be noted that urethane masks is a worse among these three masks. The performance of the fabric mask is not so drastically degraded because of the lower pressure drops of the material. Now let's see what happens once what is happening around the masks once you wear. Here, first of all, I would like to see the result of the medical N95 mask. See, here the red indicates the droplet trapped by the mask. We can see that all the droplets are perfectly trapped by the mask. Now let's see a fabric mask and also a urethane mask. Here, blue shows the droplets are permeating through the mask, while yellow indicates the leaking from the gap. Compared with the fabric masks, more droplets are gone out from the urethane. So urethane masks performance, as I showed you, that is worse, and much droplets leaks, and also the permeating through the masks. And between the cotton mask on the middle and the polyester mask on the right, the polyester shows a better performance. In fact, when we look at the results of a non-woven mask next, as you see, some non-woven masks performance looks almost similar to the polyester fabric mask. So when you handmade some masks, I recommend you to use a polyester, which sometimes shows a similar performance as a commercial non-woven mask. And among the non-woven masks, this is the one of the best non-woven masks we can buy in the market. In this case, the filter performance is almost the same as N95, but unfortunately, due to it's a very large pressure droplet, I mean the drag of the mask, substantial amount of the particles leaks from the gap. This is the quantitative evaluations of the three masks, a commercial non-woven mask, handmade fabric mask made by polyester, and the right is a handmade fabric mask made by cotton. And here, the red color means the particle numbers are trapped, and green is permeating particles, and blue is a leaking particles. As you see that compared with the three cases, the commercial non-woven mask performance is the best, but the cotton mask is the worst. You can easily compare this performance by looking at the red color. Here, the bar shows the particles of the different sizes. In anyways, when you wear a mask, the larger particles are almost perfectly blocked, but the smaller particles, more or less, leaks or the permeating through the mask. But when you look at the polyester results and the commercial results, and the performance finally is almost the same. In the case of a polyester mask, more droplets are permeating through the mask because of the lower filtering performance than the non-woven mask. But on the other hand, the percentage of the leakage is slightly lower than the commercial non-woven mask because of the lower pressure drag. As a result of that, these two masks show a similar performance finally. Now, next, I would like to show how much masks can protect yourself from infection. Here, we consider the situations of the with and the without mask during deep breathing to see how much droplets with different sizes come into the upper respiratory tract. At the initial conditions, droplets of various sizes distribute uniformly around the face. Then we count the particles coming into your body. On your left is a no mask case, on your right is a non-woven mask case. And the color indicates the size of the droplets. Here, we assume that the breathing is through both nose and the mask. As you see on the left animation, smaller droplets indicated by the blue comes deep into the upper respiratory tract, while relatively larger droplets attach on the surface of oral and nasal cavities. Once you wear a mask on the right, larger droplets are mostly blocked, almost perfectly blocked by the mask. And only the smaller droplets, maybe the less than the 50 micrometers, come into the respiratory tract. And the problem is a very small droplets, less than 5 micrometers, indicated by blue color, which goes deep into the respiratory tracts. This is a limitation of the mask. I would like to skip this figure. This is a quantitative evaluation of how much droplets reaches which part of upper respiratory tract. But roughly speaking, mask can reduce the total droplet and aerosol number by one third once you wear the mask. The blocking effect on the aerosol is limited and difficult to stop coming into from the gap. This is the limitations of the mask. In fact, when you look at the droplets, which are size less than the maybe the 10 micrometers, no matter whether you wear a mask and you do not wear the mask, it reaches deep into the trachea. This is the limitation. Now I'd like to move on to the infection risk evaluations on the table for persons sitting here. First, we like to investigate the effect of distance on the dispersions. Here, we count the number of droplets and aerosol reaching to the person in front of or in diagonal to the cover. This is the case of 1.2. This is the case of 1.2, and this is the 1.0, and this is a 0.8 meter away from the cover. So this is the front persons to be evaluated. And when you look at these results, as you see that most of the larger particles indicated by droplets, indicated by the red colors, are falling down on the desk, as you see. But if the distance is shorter than the 1 meter, as you see, sometimes even the larger droplet reaches the front person, and the situation is going to be very critical. When we count the droplet or aerosols reaching to the person in front, we can evaluate the sort of the infection risks and its dependence on the distance. And this is the results in the middle. This is the case of 1.2 meter. This is a 1 meter. This is a 0.8 meters. And a vertical indicates the percentage of droplets reaching to the front person. When the distance is less than 1 meter, the risks are gonna be a double, as you see. So maybe the 1 meter is a kind of the key to identify the risk of infection risk directly from the droplet. It is also very interesting that this is the number of the droplets reaching to the diagonal persons. When you sit diagonally, then the number of the droplets, you can drastically reduce the number of droplets reaching. Which is less than 1 meter, less than 1% in this case. So from this result clearly indicates that a droplet dispersion is quite directed and depending on the direction of cough. Next, I would like to talk about the humidity of the air and its effect on the aerosol dispersions. First, let's see the result of 60%. We can see that let's see the 90% next. By comparing these two situations, you can see many droplets falling down on the desk if the humidity is higher. You see that the larger droplets indicated by yellow and the red touching on the desk, while in the case of 60%, it is reduced. This is because of the evaporations of the droplets. And in the winter seasons, when the humidity becomes lower than the 50%, like the 30% or 20%, you see much more aerosols, which is a result of the evaporations of larger droplets drifting in the air. Compared with the cases of a larger humidity case. In fact, when we count the number of the droplets reaching to the front persons, you see that between the 30 to 60%, the reaching the droplets drastically increase. So we can say that in the winter season, maybe the ventilation is going to be the very, very important. In addition to these simulations, we are also doing conducting the infection risk evaluations in the public transportations, and we are proposing some countermeasures to that. This is the result of commuter trains. Here, we mainly investigate the effect of opening the windows when the train is running. Here we assume that the red color indicates a sort of the contaminated air. It's a contaminated scale as initial conditions, and then we start the ventilations and see how the air is going to be cleaned up. Here the clean air is indicated by blue. You can clearly observe that when you open the windows, the ventilation is enhanced. Now about 3 minutes had passed from the ventilation starting. You see the below, so air is gonna be a blue, but in the case you close the windows, still the air is not so clean compared with the window open case. This is a quantitative evaluations of the effect of opening the windows. This is the cases you close the windows and the ventilation is conducted on only the mechanical ventilation system. This is a case of you open by the 5 centimeter, 10 centimeter, 15 centimeter, and 20 centimeters. And you can enhance the ventilations when you widely open the window. Another interesting thing is that we also investigate the effect of opening and closing the doors when the train is in the station. This is also the situations that we can enhance the ventilations. So roughly speaking, its ventilation effect is almost the same as the cases when the train is running at 80 kilometers per hour with a 5 centimeter window opening. So we can say that when you ride on the commuter trains, so it frequently stops like the every 2 minutes or so. Maybe you don't have to open the window, just doors opening and closing enhance the ventilation. Another situation is the airplanes, and also this is also the ventilation evaluations. The results clearly say that within the 3 minutes, the airs in the cabin is going to be cleaned up. And these results indicate the cases people cough without and with mask in the cabins. Because of the ventilation system, somehow the stronger airs is blowing in the cabins. But even in these situations, it's better to wear the mask. You can easily identify it by comparing these two animations. Here we like to focus on the situations of the taxi 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 situations. Here we consider the real taxis provided by Toyota Motor Companies, and we investigate the effect of partitions as well as ventilation systems. The simulation is something like this. A vehicle is running at 40 kilometers per hour in the urban area, and the two persons are sitting in the rear, and the air conditioning ventilation mode is should be the ventilation mode, not a circulating mode. And here we compare the two situations of the normal mode and the maximum mode of the ventilation. First, let's look at when we look at the ventilations of the cabins, we can obtain a very interesting result. This is a cases on your this figure indicates the ventilations for the various situations when you totally close the window at 40 kilometers with a normal mode, and this is a maximum mode with a window close, and this is the result that the windows are opening. Please note that vertical indicates the ventilation rate. It's a unit is a cubic meter per hour. So how much fresh air is coming in the cabins? In the case you close the window and the air conditioning in the normal situations, about 85 seconds you can replace the airs in the cabins. And you can make it a double when you set up the air conditioning maximum mode. And when you open the window, the additional ventilations is only the 25 increase. So Regarding the ventilations, opening a window is not efficient, not effective in the in these types of a small taxi. These results show the diffusions of the particles when the person coughs. Above is a driver is coughing. The below is a passenger coughing. With window closed on your left and with open with windows open on your right, both situations you cannot see the drastic difference. So I do not recommend to open the windows in the taxi and just you switch on the air conditioning system. And once you feel that there are so many persons in the taxis, then you just turn up the air conditioning system to enhance the ventilation. I would like to skip this one. So this is the effect of the partitions around the drivers. Partition works very well. Partition works very well, but not so effective for the aerosols. In addition to these public transport, we are also conducting the risk evaluations in the many indoor environment, including the office rooms, hospital rooms, public restaurants, and also the rooms and schools. Here, for example, when you look at the hospital rooms, this is a comparison of the two situations that the air conditioning is on or off. Of course, once you open, switch on the air conditioning, the mixing of the air is enhanced, and the results of that, you can obtain the higher ventilations in the air. And also the public restaurants, you can see that sometimes mouth sealed works fine compared with the cases without without a mouth sealed or without any with anything. Then we recommend to wear the mouth sealed when you when you eat or drink. Finally, I'd like to show you the some results to start social activities. We need some guidelines to reduce infection risk. So we sometimes provide such data to a government. Here, we evaluate the risks of the chorus. Actually, the chorus is one of the serious situations, as Professor Stones told us, and so many droplets and aerosol emitted. And in this case, what's happened when we reduce the peoples? Reducing the people sometimes, of course, that is good to reduce the risk of a direct droplet infections. But sometimes it is not works well for the aerosols. In the case people gathering together, the so-called thermal plume appears above the peoples, which drift the aerosol upward. But if you reduce the peoples, sometimes such a thermal plume is going to be weak, and as a result of that, aerosol drift around us. So one of the key to reduce the risk is wear the mask guard, a mask shield for every person. There we can block the direct droplet flying and also the airs, and only the smaller droplets called aerosol drift in the air. We are also conducting these evaluations of the entire music halls and how much time is required to totally repress the airs by the fresh ones. But I'd like to skip these ones and would like to conclude my talk. Droplets aerosol dispersion simulation has been conducted on the massively parallel simulations, and their infection risk have been evaluated at various cases. Two different countermeasures are necessary for the larger droplets and the smaller aerosol infections. And the visualizing the invisible virus is a very powerful tool for the enlightenment of people realizing its infection risks. And the situation of COVID-19 changes moment by moment, and the same is also true for the necessary information required by the public. Thus, among various cases required, choosing the proper topics is quite important in your activity. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Tsubokura. for very informative talk. So now we can take a few questions from the audience to Spokra Sensei. Starting from simple questions. So you talked about the effect of the air temperature, in cold temperature, there are more effect, more spread of the droplet. Now, is it because of the viscosity or some evaporation effect?
It's a humidity. Once the humidity become lower, the evaporations of the droplets enhanced. So the many aerosols are going to drift in the air. So the risk of aerosols are going to be increased in the winter season. But that is only the viewpoint of the fluid mechanics. Some medical doctors said that once air is dried and the droplet is dried, then the some virus is going to be inactive. So some medical doctors said that lower humidity is better better. But from the viewpoint of the fluid mechanics, I think the lower humidity is increase the risk, I think. But that is only the one aspect.
So there is a question regarding this evaporation. Your simulation model explains the shrinkage of the droplet size. However, can the model express the manner in which each virus moves out from the droplet? So what happens if the size of the aerosol become too small, or the virus just virus? You don't count that effect.
When the droplets evaporate, the size becomes smaller. We take into account that effect, but the number of the virus in the droplet does not decrease. For example, there are two droplets with different size. One droplet, 1 micrometer. The other, 0.5 micrometer, but that is due to the evaporations. It means if the initial condition is the same size, then the number of the droplet is a number of number of virus is the same, no matter whether its size is different.
What is the minimum droplet size you can simulate in your work?
In your case, 0.3 micrometers.
Uh-huh.
0.3. The initial condition is 1 micrometer up to several hundred micrometers, but due to the evaporations, some droplets are going to be down to 0.3 micrometers.
And then there are some smallest droplets can vanish after evaporation, and in that case, you consider the virus is not present in the air.
In our simulations, the droplet does not disappear.
Really?
Okay. 0.3 meter, it just drift. Just drift.
I see. Okay, a few questions common to two speakers. For instance, the speaking loudly makes a jet or puff and the transmission of the droplet or virus for large distance. However, if we speak very in small sound and very fast and small sound, like ventriloquism in squawjutsu in Japanese, in that case, can we prevent the spreading of virus? The same, maybe similar question from myself. There is a difference between the language and phonetic, in language. For instance, maybe in Japanese, maybe we speak less loudly and we don't have much sound like P consonant like P. And is there any dependence on the different language to the spreading in speech?
I can just give a short answer. I think this is a question that people are asking, and I don't think the answer is known. I think there are two things I can say, which is that there is one paper, which I think I mentioned in my talk, by the group of William Ristenpart, and they looked at a few languages, and I don't think found large differences. I think the languages were English, Arabic, and something else. But in that article, I think they do refer to a case in China where there were both American tourists and Japanese tourists present during one of the virus epidemics in the early 2000s, I think. And although there were more Japanese tourists, I think more Americans got sick. And I think there was a suggestion that there might have been a language connection, but I think it's an open question. And I might have that wrong or whatever, but there are a couple of these remarks in the literature about asking about the role of language just for the reasons you said.
Yeah, in our team, we are also conducting the experiment with the collaborations of some foreign students. And there is a difference among the language, like Chinese, Japanese, Korean language, and also English. There is a difference. That is definite. But so far, our simulation, we just use the English case, the one counting 1 to 10. But now we are realizing that we have to take into account the difference of the language. As Professor Stone told us, that there are several publishments which are stating the effect of the difference of language. And also with regard to the singing case, the loud singing is not, loudly speaking is not the only problem, but a so-called articulation. Articulation is very important. If you would like to speak clearly, always number of droplets are going to increase. And if you speak very not clearly, like some elderly Japanese persons, in that case, the droplet does not emit so much. So not only the loud sound, but also the articulation is very important.
Okay, thank you. So there is a other question about the coughing. So here the speaking and singing are considered, but it seems that coughing is more risky. And what is your opinion about this?
Should I answer?
Yes.
Yes, coughing is also is a very risky, but let's say, yeah. So when we look in our numerical conditions, when people speak about when people sing 1 minute, the number of droplets is almost equivalent to the coughing once. So 1 minute singing is equivalent to one cough. So I think the cough is also very risky situation.
Yeah, I think at least in some of the literature, although the cough looks the worst, just for the reason Professor Subakura said, when you speak or sing, you're producing them continuously. And if you sort of add all that up, I think the suggestion has been that these casual interactions of speaking and singing are worse.
Yeah, but when people are coughing, they wear a mask or they will not go out and talk to people. So that's a point that Professor Stone argued about the asymptomatic or the presymptomatic people can spread.
Yeah, I should say it's why in my group, when we started this, we knew there were many people working on coughing and sneezing. And so we because we had noticed this issue of asymptomatic spread, we decided to spend our energy on those cases where people weren't coughing and sneezing, just for the reason you said. Those people generally are staying isolated, and yet the virus is still being transmitted at large rates.
As far as I understand, the worst scenario is a risk, especially, you know, in the Japanese style izakaya, the pub restaurants. People are sitting very close with each other, taking off the mask and speaking a very, very long time, like 1 hour or 2 hours continuously speaking loudly. That is one of the very worst scenario in Japan, I think. And the Professor Sano told us that once you wear a mask and a cough, and it's infection risk is more or less smaller than compared with the case you are continuously speaking in the restaurants for the long time.
How is the ventilation then in these smaller Japanese restaurants and bars?
That is a very good question. Sometimes it's worse because in the larger buildings and equipment is well established, the risk is not so high. But sometimes the small restaurants, like the small izakaya in Japan, the building is very, very old, and also ventilation system is very old. So the, as a result of that, fresh air does not come frequently in the room. So the situation is going to be worse. So when the people are speaking a very long time, many people speaking there for a very long time, then the aerosols are going to be appearing there.
So a few questions about the simulation. So in Japan, we have a problem of a domestic infection, the family infection inside the family. Mm. Is there any simulation like that? Also, there's simulation about the train. Do you have simulation of spread of droplet inside the train, like an airplane simulation?
Okay, in the case of the commuter trains, there is no need to conduct the direct droplet simulations because now, in the trains, many people wearing the mask already. So yeah, of course we can do the simulations and we can do the simulation, but there's no meaning because many people now wearing the mask in the trains does not speak. So in such a situation, we would like to show that some shocking animations to public. But that is the reason we do not conduct the direct droplet simulations in the commuter trains. The reason we conduct the direct droplet simulation in the airplane is still there is some passengers, they decline the asking of the wearing the mask in the airplane. So we conducted that simulation this time. For the commuter trains, I think that is not necessary. And regarding the in-house infections, we cannot propose useful countermeasures to prevent the infections because in the house, all the families are gathering together. In such situations, it is very difficult to avoid the infections. That is it's a sort of the most difficult situations it's a difficult situation that we cannot avoid the infections. What do you think, Professor Stone, in the in-house infection?
So I think it's a problem, but I'm wondering if you consider things you can do to mitigate it. I assume, and I'm guessing in Japan, there are many smaller homes than, for example, some of the homes in the United States. But I know in my case, I bought these portable air purifiers, which filter air and effectively produce fresh air. So I'm wondering how much in Japan people have thought about in these home situations, trying to do more with portable air purification in homes to try to increase the effective ventilation rate to do things. And I know in my case, since I have a young daughter that kind of works and has more contacts, I often wear the mask at home when she's in the same room. Now, I think mask wearing is much more common in Japan, but do people only wear it outside or do they also wear it inside?
No.
So I think there might be strategies that if what you're saying is true, that the transmission is more frequent in small settings, maybe there are other things you can think about with respect to ventilation or continuing the mask wearing in these closer contacts, because it's when you share this air that you have the most risk.
Yeah, I agree that wearing the mask in the house is a good countermeasure, I think. But so far, I think that most of the Japanese people does not wear a mask in house, I think. What do you think, Professor Sano-sensei?
I think it's difficult to wear a mask in house.
Yeah.
But some people now suggest to use a humidifier as well as a air cleaner and ventilation. Those may help.
Yeah, anyway, very, very simply speaking, two important things is the time and the distance to avoid the infections. Take distance and also shorten the time when we talk. That is the two main keys to reduce the infection risk. And when we stay in the house, it is very difficult to take the distance, and we also stay there for the very long time. So it's a kind of the worst scenarios, I think.
Okay, let's take the final question for two speakers. So one audience asked, what's the relation between the computer simulation and the experiment and theory? For instance, the Professor Stone did all of them, but the simplest experiment using smoke machine, using smoke, can visualize and enable us to measure the dynamics. And however, the COVID-19 is very specific, has a very specific feature. The speech can spread the virus among the social community. So I think this kind of detailed study, including experiment theory and the computer simulation, has never been done previously. I think these research will contribute. Will be useful for preventing. For protecting from spreading virus. Do you have any comment about the use of the experiment and the theory and the computer simulation for the mitigation of the spread of virus? Then first, Tsubokura-sensei.
Yeah, first of all, I would like to say that our simulation cannot be done without experimental data. So the always experimental data is indispensable. And both methods and the three methods have a good point and a weak point. So by using these three methods is quite important. And I think the advantage of the numerical simulations, we can apply that method to various situations, airplanes, trains, and also the concert halls, everything. So for these 6 months, we apply this method to many situations. But the basics of our simulations, like the boundary conditions, we utilize experimental data. So the experimental data is quite valuable for us. Without that, we cannot do the numerical simulation.
Okay, thank you. How about Professor Stone?
I think I'd want to make a couple points. One is one that Professor Subukura made in his talk, and that is, I think one very valuable feature of the experiments and the simulations, individually or together, is helping other people visualize what happens when they have these casual conversations, because we don't realize how much of the air we, if you like, contaminate when we speak with people. And beyond that, of course, then the air mixes in the room and it points out the role of the ventilation. I don't think our simulations or experiments are accurate enough to tell you exactly where all the air goes in these complicated spaces, because we don't even know, as you and Professor Subukura said, all the boundary conditions. But it can highlight the importance in spaces of doing a better job with ventilation and or making very basic measurements of, for example, CO2 in the space to understand how much fresh air there might be in the space. And so I think it's some combination of these things that will both improve the engineering and maybe improve the way we manage ourselves and our communities to have a safer environment to lower the transmission rate, if that is clear enough.
Okay, thank you very much. So finally, we would like to thank the two prominent speakers today. And this concludes our program of the Tokyo College webinar today. And the after closing webinar, for the audience, the screen for the questionnaire enquete in Japanese will appear. Please answer to the question on the screen. Okay, Tokyo College will continue to deliver lectures and symposium. Thank you for your continued support of Tokyo College. Thank you for very much for your kind attention. Thank you very much. Bye.